Hare Krishna. So today we are gathered on the supremely auspicious occasion of Shri Gaur Purnima. It's the appearance day of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who is the avatar, the incarnation of the Lord for this age of Kali. So I will speak about the glory of Shri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu based on a beautiful play written by one of his prominent followers, Kavi Karnapura. So he has written a play called Chaitanya Chandrodya Nataka. And in this play, he describes how Shri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu conquered over the illusory forces of the world. And from that, we will also learn about how we can conquer over the illusory forces of the world. So when Shri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu appeared, he appeared around 500 years ago in Bengal, in India. And that was a time when there was a literary effervescence in the area of Bengal. So Kavya and Nataka, poetry and drama were very big at that time. In fact, dramaturgy had a big renaissance during that period. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his followers have presented timeless truths to the means of drama. So now, in drama, there's a book for dramaturgy. There's a book written by Rupa Goswami called Natak Chandrika, The Moonlight of Drama. And there he describes how the purpose of drama, the purpose of natya is to evoke bhav, to evoke emotion. And for that, there are three kinds of characters that are used. There are historical, non-historical, and a combination of historical, non-historical. So in this particular natak, that is Chaitanya Chandrodaya Nataka, is envisioned a conversation between adharma and kali. Dharma is religion or right behavior basically. Religion is a very broad, dharma is a very broad word. But broadly it is the right way of action. So adharma is the wrong way of action. And adharma personified is the force who pushes us towards wrong ways of action. And kali is the in charge of the current age. So Kavi Karnapura is one of the most brilliant authors in the Gaudiya tradition along with the Goswamis, and his works are filled with poetry and artistry. So he narrates the glory of Shri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu through the conversation between adharma and kali. So adharma and kali are speaking, and adharma says, "Oh Kali, now this is the age for you to rule. You can delude and degrade people according to your will. Nobody can challenge you in this age." And Kali is looking sad. He's not at all looking like a monarch who has got untrammeled power. He said, "Yes, it was supposed to be like that, but everything has been foiled. So I see only gloom and dark everywhere." He says, "Why?" He says, there is a young Brahmana boy who is going to thwart all my plans. A young Brahmana boy? You have by your power brought down great warriors. What can a boy do? Who is this boy?" Kali says, "Actually, Navadvip was filled with dharma. But I deluded people so that they had dharma without bhakti. So that people were pious, but they were not spiritual. They would do religious rituals, but they would not think of raising their consciousness. So in this way, I kept them under my clutches through piety. But this boy, when he was born, right from his birth, he started thwarting my plans. He said he chose to appear at the time of an eclipse. Now, traditionally, eclipses are considered to be inauspicious times, because either the sun or moon, which are two prominent luminous bodies, get covered by other celestial objects. So, because these periods are considered inauspicious, so traditionally, even those people who are not devotees, even they, at the time of eclipse, chant the holy names. So, when this boy, Nimai, appeared, he chose to appear at the time of an eclipse. Normally, if a child is born at the time of an eclipse, that is not considered very auspicious, because the time itself is not auspicious. But this boy, he appeared at that time, and because it was an eclipse, so everybody at that time had gone to the Ganga, and either in the Ganga or near the Ganga, they were loudly chanting the holy names of Hari, Hari. Kindly repeat. Hari, Hari. Hari, Hari. Hari, Hari. So at that time they were not chanting Hare Krishna, because Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had not yet broadcast the mantra. The mantra was there in the Upanishads, but it had not yet been broadcast so much. So he said, right from his birth itself, his appearance itself, he made the inauspicious eclipse auspicious. And similarly, he has made this inauspicious age of Kali auspicious. He started thwarting me right from his birth. As he started growing up, then I decided to distract him by playfulness. So I sent around him lot of other children, and he used to play, and he became very mischievous. And I thought that I had deluded him. But although he was playful, still he did not forget Krishna. Whenever he would cry, there's only one way he would stop crying. And what was that? Again, chanting the holy names. That is the only way he would stop. And wherever, no matter how mischievous he was, still, he was always connected to the holy name. Then, I came up with another plan. That he had only one brother. Actually, his parents had many children before, but they all passed away, very young, either before birth or immediately after birth. So he had only one brother, Vishwarup, and he was Vishwambar or Nimai. So his parents were naturally very affectionate to his two children, two sons. But then I made a plan so that his attachment to his family would increase. I arranged for his older brother to leave home and take sannyas. When his older brother left home, now he became the only shelter for his parents. And I thought that by that, affection to his parents would bind him. And as I was seeming to be successful, I cast another rope. I made him very attached. I presented around him many scholars, scholarly students, scholarly teachers, and he became caught in scholarship. In scholarship, which was based on, which was scriptural, but not spiritual. Normally we think of scripture as giving spiritual knowledge, but scripture gives a lot of other knowledge apart from spiritual knowledge also. In scripture, there is paravidya and there is aparavidya. Paravidya is spiritual knowledge, aparavidya is material knowledge. So, I got him caught in the non-spiritual scriptural knowledge. Logic, argumentation, debate, and he became a master in that. And what was thought was his greatest victory was actually my greatest victory. He became such a great scholar that just at the age of 14, he had his own school. He had started his own teaching academy. He had not only graduated
in grammar, in learning Sanskrit grammar, he also become his own teacher. And he had many students from far and wide coming to him. I thought, by this, he will become proud. And through that pride, I will entangle him. And then, to further his pride, I send a great scholar, Keshav Kashmiri. And this scholar was so powerful that everybody in the world ran in fear from him. Even the great scholars in Navadvip ran in fear from him. When he came, they all disappeared. And he confronted Nimai Pandit, and Nimai Pandit effortlessly defeated him. And I thought, this is a sure trap. For a small child to defeat a world-renowned scholar, it's like, say, in tennis, you know, some qualifier comes into Wimbledon and defeats a world champion. The world number one becomes the champion. It's very easy to become inflated. At least to become, not, if not inflated, at least infatuated. Inflated means one thinks I am so great. Infatuated means one thinks this is the greatest thing. I don't want anything else in my life. But Adharma and Kali are discussing and they're saying that didn't work. Although he was celebrated as such a great scholar, but then he met a great devotee, Ishwar Puri. And just by meeting that devotee, all his attraction to scholarship disappeared. And his attraction became completely towards Krishna. He went to meet Ishwar Puri again in Gaya and he got initiation from him. And then, wherever he was earlier studying scholarship, through all scholarship, he saw nothing but Krishna. Since my attempt to make him proud was completely baffled. It's completely baffled. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu demonstrates that yes, it is easy to become proud if we have intellectual prowess. But the sweetness of devotion is far greater than the pleasure of pride. When we want to be proud, we need to have some glories. Oh, I can do this so well, I can do that so well, I can do that so well. And now to delight in our glories is what the essence of pride is. But in that, there are two problems. First is that we don't have too many glories. We don't have too many glories. And even whatever little glories we have, they can be taken away at any moment. That's why trying to delight in pride is always very insecure. But instead, if we learn to delight not in our glories, but in Krishna's glories. Krishna's glories are unlimited and Krishna's glories are inexhaustible. Tvatvirya gayan mahamritamagna chittaha. Prahlad Maharaj says in his prayers, my dear Lord, in glorifying you, I am relishing the supreme nectar and no temptation can trouble me now. Naivodvijay paraduratyaya vaitaranyas. I don't feel tempted at all. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu attained the pinnacle of scholarship, but then he showed that far greater than that is the joy of devotion. It is. So he shows how by focusing on devotion, by relishing Krishna's glories, we can overcome whatever temptation might be there. And further, he said that, I thought that maybe I will use something else. See, maybe, if not pride, then I will use greed. How greed? He said that, and that was a time when scholarship was immensely respected. And when scholarship was respected, the brahmanas would not directly take any salary for their scholarship. But they would be given charity. And because Nimai Pandit became such a phenomenal scholar, wherever he would go, people would come to hear his talks and give him profuse dakshina. Bhaktivinoda Thakur talks about this, you know, Vidyara Gaurave Pramideshe Deshe Dhana Uparjana Kari. He says, with the pride of my knowledge, I travel from place to place. And dhana uparjana kari. I gained a lot of wealth. So Nimai Pandit, as a scholar, when he was there in first in Navadvip. Now here we are going slightly back. Earlier I talked about how he overcame pride by becoming a devotee. But here is slightly weird. He's still a scholar. So at that time he travelled all across Bengal. At that time all of Bengal was one country. Now it is India and Bangladesh. He went to Bangladesh, he even went to Burma. He went far and wide. Wherever he travelled, he got profuse gifts. Now he could. Now Brahmanas generally are not very wealthy. Because Brahmanas don't chase after money. And they live on charity. And Jagannath Mishra, Nimai Pandit's father, was not poor, but he was never wealthy also. But now Nimai Pandit got wealth like never before. And when he got all this wealth, by that time, his father had also passed away. So he could have seen this wealth. Oh, this is what I need. And he could have got attached to it. But he came back, and with all the gifts that he had got, just kept a few for himself and gave everything else in charity to the other Brahmanas, to the other devotees. And Adharma and Kali, they started beating their heads. What is this? He says, this person is not attracted by greed at all. In the Bhagavatam, it is said that greed is purified by charity. If somebody has greed, a lot of desire to earn wealth, just tell them, don't earn wealth. That is not going to work. That desire is there. That desire cannot be given up. But the fruits of that desire can be given up. Giving up the desire for earning money is not as easy as earning money and giving up that money. That is also difficult. But relatively speaking, it is easier. And because when we earn money and give it to Krishna, what happens? The desire for wealth is in our heart. But when we give that wealth to Krishna, we give Krishna a place in our heart. Ultimately, our purpose is to give our heart to Krishna. But if we can't give our heart to Krishna, we give what is in our heart to Krishna. If we can't give Krishna, we give what is in our heart to Krishna. And by that, we give Krishna a place in our heart. And then Krishna, after he gets a small place, gradually expands and he becomes the ruler of our heart. So, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he was Nimai Pandit, he was a scholar, but he was not tempted by wealth. So, Kali and Adharma are saying, oh, our plan to trap him by greed was also foiled. Then, we thought, we will trap him by lust. Since he was young, and we arranged to have him married to a very beautiful woman. And for some time, he seemed to be living entangled in grihastha life. But then, when he went on his teaching tour, at that time, his wife couldn't tolerate the separation. And Lakshmi Priya, she passed away. Chaitanya Bhagavat says poetically that the serpent of separation from her Lord couldn't bear it. Now, Kali and Dharma are saying that this wrenched our plans. We thought he will become attached, but nature intervened. But then we influenced. Vanmali was the matchmaker over there. And we influenced him so that he again came. And he proposed another match for Chaitanya, for Nimai Pandit. And then when he got married again to Vishnu Priya, now she was young, she was beautiful, she was chaste. She served Lord Chaitanya, she served her mother Shachi Mata. And in every way, his life was idyllic. Sometimes, or many times when we get a desire for renunciation, most of us, if at all we get a desire for renunciation, that renunciation is primarily because of frustration. You know, we want to, we have plans to enjoy some things, and when they don't work out, let me just give this up. So, when things are not working out, to give them up is relatively easier. Of course, in Kali Yuga, when there is frustration, people don't go towards renunciation. People go towards some other, something else. What is that? You know, there is a difference between, if you consider there is frustration, renunciation. Frustration is broadly in the mode of passion going towards ignorance. Renunciation is going towards goodness. But in Kali Yuga, what are we having? We are not having renunciation. What we are having is aversion to commitment. Aversion to commitment means people want to have all options open and just continue doing what they want to do. If this doesn't work out, try that. If that doesn't work out, try that. Try that. So, but for Nimai Pandit, there was no frustration. His mother was very loving, his wife was very loving, and not just loving, but they were also pious. So he had every excuse, every reason to continue on in material life. But at that time, he, Kali and Adharma are saying, we don't understand how. He developed a desire for renunciation. And when he was very young, just at the age of 24, he took sannyas. And this was like a deadly blow for all our plans. He said that whatever we had planned, everything was thwarted when he took sannyas. Then we came up with another plan. Somehow we said, no, we have to succeed. We cannot let this Nimai thwart our rule. Kali Yuga, we are meant to rule. And how dare he come and thwart our rule? So, what were they afraid of? This young, beautiful boy, Nimai. Now he, when he took sannyas, he became Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And when he became Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, even before that, he had started the chanting of the holy names. And the chanting of the holy names is such a process. It is so spiritually infectious. It is so spiritually infectious that normally when an infection comes, it comes into our body and then it spreads. And when it spreads, if a material infection comes, the disease spreads in our body and it erodes and destroys our health. But it is spiritually infectious. When it enters into the heart, it just spreads in the heart so much that all material attachments are destroyed by it. So, we thought initially we will stop it. So, what they did was that initially Nimai Pandit started the kirtan, but he was doing it in a closed place. He was doing it in the house of one of his associates, Srivas Pandit. And only those who were great devotees, they were allowed to enter. Those who were like-minded, those who were devoted, only they could enter. And there was great ecstasy over there. And through that ecstasy, they were rising higher and higher. But it was enclosed, it was private. And we thought that anyway, this is not spreading. We will, it is already contained, we will contain it further. So how? Our plan was that in this pure kirtan, if people who are self-centered come in, so we arrange for a brahmana. The brahmanas, they thought they are very pious and they said, this kirtan is going on. Normally, if any religious festival, religious ceremony is to be held, the traditional culture was that those who are brahman priests, they would come and conduct the ceremony. So, if there is a marriage ceremony, if there is a home entering, home warming ceremony, then traditionally some priests would be invited and the priests would officiate the ceremony. But bhakti is universal spirituality. Bhakti makes spirituality universally accessible. So, for chanting, for doing the kirtan of the holy names of the Lord, you don't need any brahminical priest. Anybody can do kirtan anywhere. So not only were the Brahmanas not invited, but they were left out. In fact, they were not allowed to come in. And some of the Brahmanas became very angry. They said, how dare you are glorifying, you are doing a religious ceremony and you are not allowing us to come? So one such Brahman, he got very angry. He thought that Kali and Adharma are discussing that if we can get this Brahmana community to oppose the Kirtan, then the Kirtan will stop. In every religious tradition, there is piety and there is spirituality. There is ritual, there are those who are ritualists and there are those who are spiritualists. And often the ritualists and the spiritualists come in conflict. It happens in every religious tradition. Now, that's what happened in Christianity when Jesus was persecuted and eventually cross-crucified. It was the people who were religious, the people in charge of the temples and the synagogues, they complained. The same thing happened over here. So the Brahmanas started opposing. And Kali thought, these Brahmanas are the holders of religious power. If they oppose, the Kirtan will stop. But what happened? This Brahmana came and he was not allowed inside. And Srivas Pandit was very respectful. He said, yes, now you are, oh venerable Brahmana, you are respectable. But this Kirtan is only for those whose heart is filled with love for Krishna. Now these Brahmanas, they were new lords of shlokas. But they did not have much love for Krishna. And then one day, when Nimai Pandit had gone out for a bath to the nearby Ganga river, when he was coming back, this Brahmana confronted him. This Brahmana had been stopped from entering into the Kirtan of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And then this Brahmana said that, you, who do you think you are? And you stop me from entering into Kirtan? I curse you. I curse you that you will no longer be able to enjoy family life. Now, because he was a pious person, he thought that dharma is for artha and kama. And therefore he thought if somebody's artha and kama are taken away, that is a curse. But Nimai Pandit, he saw that as a blessing. So you take artha and kama away, then I'll just focus directly on bhakti, directly on prema. So we thought that when he would be cursed like this, you know, he will decrease his kirtans and he will try to pacify the Brahmanas. But instead, he turned it around and he became even more devoted. Then we thought of another way to stop the kirtans. Some of these Brahmanas, they went and complained to the Qazi. At that time, India was ruled by Islamic rulers. And some of them were very intolerant. So many temples were desecrated, many priests and religious people were persecuted. And because of that, what happened was the religious tradition, it didn't disappear, but it transformed itself. So Nimai Pandit, when he was Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, as long as in Bengal, he did not ask any of his devotees to build temples over there. Because at that time, the Muslim ruler was very tyrannical over there, Nawab Hussain Shah. So he said, don't try to build any temples. But what they did, just do kirtans. Now when you're doing kirtans, you can do kirtan anywhere. And if somebody comes, you can just take up the kirtan paraphernalia and go away from there. So there is nothing to destroy. So kirtan is actually, you could say, very portable spirituality. The temple is not portable spirituality. Temple has to be at one place, you have to have roots. But the spiritual tradition is always very resilient. If some obstacle comes, some way it is found. Just as it says Ganga always moves towards the ocean. Similarly, devotees always find a way to move towards Krishna. Now what was done by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu about 500 years ago, that's what our devotees are doing currently in the Middle East. In the Middle East, there are several countries, there are hundreds and hundreds of devotees. I was in one place in the Middle East, and the devotees can't even have a temple over there. They hire a hall. But in that hall, they have like 800 people for the Sunday feast. And in the morning, they come there by 10 o'clock, 10 to 1 or something, they have been allowed the hall. So they set up the altar, they do aarti, they do kirtan, and they can't even take prasad over there. So everybody brings packed prasadam boxes. And it's at 9:45, it's just like another hall in the Middle East. From 10 to 1, it is vibrant with Krishna kirtan and Krishna katha. And 1:50, everything is over. So it's literally portable. And there are just, as there, just one, three cities are just about 1.5 hours away from each other. Each of them has not their Sunday feast, they have Friday feast program over there, because Friday is the holiday. So on Friday, each of these places, 1.5 hours away, one place has 800 people, another place has 600 people, another place has 400 people. And bhakti is resilient. Wherever there is a desire of the heart, Krishna will give devotees the intelligence to practice. So here Adharma and Kali are discussing, and he said, so when this kirtan was going on, it was still going on and on, so we decided to use the Islamic rulers to stop the kirtans. And so when the complaint reached the Qazi came over there. And this Qazi, he came with his servants, and when the devotees were doing kirtan, he barged into the place where kirtan was going on, and he broke the mridanga. And now, when he broke the mridanga like that, Kali and Adharma were thinking, this will terrorize the devotees. And the devotees will give up kirtan. And yes, some of the devotees did get terrorized by that. But at that time when the Qazi had come, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was not there. So at that time, because Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was not there, the Qazi came and went, and he said, this time I just stopped the kirtan. Next time if you again do kirtan, he didn't use the word, he said, you are making so much noise. If you make this noise again, then I will put you all, tie a rock around your head and throw you into Ganga. So then the devotees became apprehensive. And when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came over there, there's practically no kirtan going on. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu asked, what happened? And as he was looking, he saw the broken shards of the mridanga. He became furious. What is this? He said that this Qazi had come. And he threatened us, he broke the mridanga. And everybody is fearful. And hearing about what the Qazi had done, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself became furious. He says, how dare anyone stop the kirtan of Krishna's holy names? And he said, we will march to the house of the Qazi, and we will challenge him. So then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu told all the devotees, you get torches, you get lamps, and let us all march. Can all of you please come a little ahead? A lot of people behind. Please move a little ahead. All of you can also. So at that time, we decided, so hundreds and thousands of people came from, we don't know from where, from everywhere, all these people crowded in, and they charged towards the house of the Qazi. And initially the Qazi was furious. He says, I told them to stop kirtans, how dare they doing kirtan like this? And he sent his messengers to find out, and the messenger said, they came back scared. They said, we see an ocean of people. And he said, why didn't you stop them? He says, we can't stop them. There are so many. The Qazi came out of his house and looked from the balcony, and when he saw, like just as long as I could see, just people. And some of them, they were all chanting Hare Krishna, But along with that, they were chanting another kirtan. Death to the Qazi. Qazi Murdabad. And the Qazi became scared. And now he was a ruler, but you know, a mass uprising, what could he do? So he locked all his doors and he went and hid in his cellar. And then, when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came right up to the door and he knocked on the door. And he knocked and knocked and knocked. And finally the Qazi servant realized, if you don't open the door, these people will break the door down. So he says, he opened the door. And then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, I want to talk with the Qazi. And then his servant ran and called the Qazi. And the Qazi came, he was very scared. And he was so scared. And then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said that, you know, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he adopted a very sweet technique. He says, you know, my father and you were friends earlier. So you are like my uncle. I came to your house as a guest. Instead of welcoming me, why did you go away like this? So the Qazi said, you did not come like a normal guest. He said, now why did you break my mridanga? And he says, the Qazi said, I'm sorry. And then they had a very nice discussion. And then at that time, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu asked him that earlier, you are so bellicose, you are so furious, you are so aggressive. Now why are you so timid? He said, he looked around. He says, can I talk privately? He says, no, all these are my associates. Tell me. No, they will not tell anything to anyone. Then he opened his kurta and his dress and he showed that night when I came back, that day when I came back and I took rest. So at that time, I saw suddenly in my room, right towering above me, a fierce creature. He had the body of a man, but he had the face of a lion. And he was roaring and he said, he caught me by the chest. And says, you broke my mridanga, you threatened my devotees. I will destroy you. So I was petrified, I couldn't speak. I just folded my hands. And I tried to speak, but no words could come out. But seeing me fearful, that mysterious being calmed down. And then he said, okay, you have not created too much trouble. But if you do this, if you create any trouble again, next time I will not spare you. And that being hurled me on the ground and it disappeared. Who was that? Narasimhadev. Narasimhadev Bhagwan ki jai. So, Chaitanya Charitamrita uses the word Gaurasimha. Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu himself came as Narasimhadev to intimidate the Qazi at night. And then again, when he was dancing and singing in kirtan, normally kirtans are very sweet, but this time the kirtans were thunderous. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came as a Simha, as a lion. That Lord who is very sweet, who is very loving, who can also be very ferocious when his devotion or his devotees are threatened. So there's all obstacles to the chanting of the holy names were all removed. And then, as Kali and Adharma are discussing, they're becoming more and more disheartened. They said that everything that we tried to do, to stop, to thwart, to baffle this Harinam Sankirtan by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, it has all been baffled. But these were our attempts to attack, which were thwarted. But then, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu did something which devastated us completely. Instead of we attacking and he defending, he attacked us. He says, how? He says, Jagai and Madai, where the prime products of Kali Yuga degradation.
Sometimes there are some educational institutes
which say, you know, these are the prime products of our academy. So you have some students come in and they say, they got the first rank in IIT, they got the first rank in this exam, that exam. They're the prime products. So there are academic institutes which take students and make them into toppers. So Kali Yuga is also like an institute. But what it does is, it is not an institute for elevation, it is an institute for degradation. So Jagai and Madai were prime products of Kali Yuga's degradation academy. What had happened? He said that they were born in very pious Brahminical families. They were born as Jagadananda and Madhavananda. And they were born to pious families. They themselves were virtuous. But Kali also tries to catch the biggest fish. Just in the army, if an ordinary soldier is killed, that's bad.
Every casualty is bad. But if the commander is killed, then the soldiers will just lose heart. So Kali's goal was not just to degrade the people who are already at a lower level. Those people who were high born, if they could be degraded, then that would be a great victory for Kali.
So Kali and Adharma conspired to surround Jagai and Madai with all kinds of bad association. And by that bad association, they became degraded. And not just degraded, they became more degraded than everyone else. In fact, it is said that they had committed so many wrongdoings that even Yamaraj and his accountant, they couldn't keep track. They got tired of keeping track of all their heinous wrongdoings. And that's way, seeing those who were highborn so degraded, Kali was thinking, yes, I have attained supremacy. But then there was this associate of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And then as Kali and Adharma are discussing, they're saying that actually Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is bad enough, but his associates are worse. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu at least is a Brahmana, he stays in Brahminical places. But he has his associate. Who is that? Nityananda. So Nityananda Prabhu, he goes to all kinds of degraded places. And he hunts for the most degraded people. So when Jagai and Madai would come to any place, everybody would run away from them because they were so impure and so impious. And when Nityananda Prabhu first time saw them, at that time, he became excited with compassion. Normally, when we see some sense object, we become excited with passion. But Nityananda Prabhu became excited with compassion. And he said, if these two people can be delivered, then the glories of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu will spread all over the world. And thus, he approached them. First time, they were so drunk and mad that they came to attack Nityananda Prabhu. Nityananda Prabhu just had to flee from there along with Haridas Thakur. But next time, again Nityananda Prabhu came. And Nityananda Prabhu came over there and he said, you know, that the holy names are so merciful. That the Lord has descended to give the holy names. Just chant the holy names, you will all be delivered. So at that time, Jagai and Madai were there. So Madai had been drinking and he had a pot of wine with him. He took that and he was so intoxicated that he became infuriated. It is a Updesho hi Murkhana Prakopaya na Shantaye. If wise people are given advice, they take the advice. But there are some people who are wise and some are otherwise. So
So those people who are otherwise. So what happens when they are given advice? Advice does not cause their vice to go down. Advice causes their vice to go up. The vice within them rises. So na prakopaya na shantaya. They become more angry. So Madai took his pot and hurled it at Dhyanand Prabhu. And Madai was hefty and the pot was heavy. And Dhyanand Prabhu was right close to him. Bang! It hit him on the head. And his head started bleeding profusely. So Adharma and Kali are discussing that at this point, when we saw Nityananda coming over there, we thought that we have to do something to ensure that these two do not go out of our clutches. So at that time, as soon as Nityananda Prabhu was attacked like this, we decided to attack Chaitanya Mahaprabhu with anger. Lust had failed, greed had failed, pride had failed, but now we will attack him with anger. And we thought we were going to be successful, because when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu heard that Nityananda Prabhu had been attacked, he came charging over there. And when he came charging over there, he saw Nityananda Prabhu bleeding and immediately he called, "Chakra! Chakra!" He called out loudly and immediately the Sudarshan Chakra appeared in his hands. And that Sudarshan Chakra, his whole body became blazing. It appeared like this. It had been night, but the night transformed into day because of the effulgence of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu as well as his chakra. And as he was about to release that chakra, at that time, Nityananda Prabhu came in between. And he said that, "Oh Lord, actually, I'm not hurt. It's just a minor wound. And anyway, when I was hurt, this Jagai stopped. Jagai stopped me from being hurt again." And just by these words, suddenly the anger of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu disappeared. For us, you know, when great souls get angry, they use anger in Krishna's service. So they are like an ocean, and anger is like a small wave on that ocean. So they are able to control their anger and use it in Krishna's service. But when we get angry, we may think I am getting angry for Krishna's service. But soon what happens? We think I am using anger in Krishna's service, and within moments, anger starts using us in Maya's service. When that anger goes out of control, we don't know. So our consciousness is not like an ocean. Our consciousness is like a puddle. If in a puddle a wave comes, a river comes up, the puddle gets devastated completely. Everything overflows. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was furious at one moment on seeing Nityananda Prabhu being assaulted. But the next moment when he heard that Nityananda Prabhu being protected, immediately his affection flew over. And he, "Hey, oh Jagai, you protected Nityai." He said, "I will embrace you." And when he embraced Jagai, by that, Jagai became filled with ecstasy. And then, not only that, Madai saw this, and Madai was first shocked to see the chakra, and then he was stunned to see his partner is so transformed emotionally. He said, "You know, we have always been partners. We are partners in crime. If he is becoming bhakta, make us partner in bhakti also." So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was still angry with him. But Nityananda Prabhu intervened. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, "You beg forgiveness from Nityananda Prabhu." Nityananda Prabhu immediately forgave him. And then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu hugged him also. And both of them became ecstatic with love for Krishna. And when the news spread, people from far and wide now they came to see this dramatic transformation of Jagai and Madai. And still, some people had suspicion. These people are so sinful. How can they be changed? How can their sins go away? So at that time, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu told them, "Watch." And as they were watching, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu embraced both of Jagai and Madai. And then something miraculous happened. The darkness of all the sins from their hearts came into Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And everybody was observing and they were amazed. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu asked, "Oh Advaita, So I had his associate Advaita said, Advaita, what is happening? So Advaita said, oh, a miracle is happening. Gaura Chandra has now become Krishna Chandra. Gaura Chandra has become Krishna Chandra. That golden lord, because the sins of Jagai and Madai entered into them, into him, his complexion changed into the opulence. And then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, start Kirtan. And as all the devotees started Kirtans, all the darkness of the sins disappeared. And again, he became Gaura Chandra. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said that all the sins of Jagai and Madai have been thrown far away. Anybody who considers them to be a sinner will be a sinner. They are no longer sinners. And when Kali and Adharma saw this, they sank into despair. They said, our best success completely foiled. What can we do? This Nimai, the Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is unstoppable. Such is the grace of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Not only did he effortlessly thwart the attacks of Kali and Adharma, but he empowered others to thwart those attacks also. He has given us the process of Bhakti Yoga, permeated specially with love for Krishna in the mood of Radharani. That is, all this we talked about is the external mission. The internal mission of Lord Chaitanya was that he was Krishna in the mood of Radharani, to taste the beauty of Krishna, to taste love for Krishna. Normally when there's a loving reciprocation, if A loves B, then, you know, if B wants to know, okay, what is it about me that A finds so lovable? So similarly, Krishna wants to know, what is it about me that Radharani loves so much? And then he also wants to know that what does she feel when she sees that I love her back? So, and what is the nature of her love? So, my attractiveness, her affection, and her ecstasy on seeing my reciprocation. This is a dynamic of love. When we love someone, you know, what is it that, what is this love? What is that attractiveness that makes that love? And when that love is reciprocated, what is the ecstasy that comes? So I want to taste it all. So these three flavors of Radharani's consciousness, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is tasting. Radha Bhava Dhyuti Subalitam Naomi Krishna Charupam. So Krishna has come in the form of Radharani's, with Radharani's mood and Radharani's complexion. And that is Shri Gauranga Mahaprabhu. Radharani is Gaurangi and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is Gauranga. So that same supreme ecstasy of love which is experienced in the highest abode of Vrindavan, in the Madhurya Prem between Radha and Krishna, that same ecstasy is available through the mercy of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And that mercy was spread by Srila Prabhupada all over the world. Srila Prabhupada, at the advanced age of 70, went all alone from India to America. And he went because he had faith that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had made a prophecy. Everywhere in the world, my holy names will be chanted. And Srila Prabhupada took Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's prophecy as his responsibility. And he traveled tirelessly across the world. And Srila Prabhupada himself transformed people who, not just one or two, but hundreds and thousands of people who were like Jagai and Madai. When Prabhupada went to America, there were the hippies over there. The hippies, their only regulative principle was to break all regulative principles. That's what they would do constantly. But Prabhupada transformed them. Prabhupada elevated them. Prabhupada made them into great devotees. Such is the potency of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's mercy. And all of us have many anarthas in our hearts. And sometimes we may feel that, oh, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu easily overcame all these anarthas, but I am not able to overcome. And when we are chanting Hare Krishna day after day, month after month, year after year, sometimes we may feel, but is this process working or is all this just exaggeration? Actually, when we feel discouraged. At that time, we can turn back and look at how far we have come. If we consider when we started bhakti 5 years ago, 10 years ago, 1 year ago, 20 years ago, if we consider how we were at that time and how we are now, we'll see definitely there has been a transformation. We have become enriched, we have become purified, we have become spiritually uplifted. So if we feel discouraged, we look back and then we get encouraged. This process does work. But if we become proud, then we need to look ahead to see how far we have to go. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, I just want to chant the holy names of Krishna constantly. Now, when we chant the holy names of Krishna, what happens? We take our japa mala and we chant. And so in a few days we feel, oh, chanting is so nice, chanting is so powerful, chanting should never end. But on most days we feel, chanting never ends. It is going on. Sometimes we take the beads out of our bead bag and we see. Instead of 108, has somebody put 1008 beads over here? But we have, though we have a long way to go, we have the Lord's mercy with us. And by the Lord's mercy, you know, what is a very, very long distance can also become a very short distance. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, by his mercy, can enrich us with faith in Krishna's Krishna Bhakti and taste for Krishna Bhakti. So on this holy day, let us pray that just as he enriched the hearts of Jagayana Madai, just as his faithful servant Srila Prabhupada enriched the hearts of so many souls, that may that Lord and his servant enrich our hearts also with love for Krishna. Shri Gauranga Mahaprabhu ki, Shri Gaur Purnima Mahamahotsav ki, Shri La Prabhupada ki, Gaur Bhakta Vrinda ki, Jai Gaur Premanande. Jai.